Hi, my name is LaJenna Frisavola. I'm a certified registered nurse anesthetist, and I'd like to talk about becoming a nurse anesthetist. Hi, good morning, everybody. My name's Jen, and I just want to talk to you guys about nurse anesthesia. A lot of people that I take care of ask me what I do for a living. So I figured I would explain to everybody just your options. There's so many different ways you can go if you go into nursing. You know, my husband is a nurse. He travels for a living. He's on airplanes all the time. You can work in doctor's offices. You can work in hospitals. You can do home care. There's just a lot of different options. So there are things called advanced practice nursing. That's what I am. I'm an advanced practice nurse. And you know of nurse practitioners, they're advanced practice nurses, and this is just another one of the options that you can get into. So I'll let you know a little bit about myself. I graduated from South Fayette High School in 1991. I originally went to Pitt for 3 semesters. I was pre-med. I thought that I wanted to be an obstetrician. Upon getting into college, I realized I was going to be in school until my mid-30s probably. In residency, medical school, that sort of thing. So I decided that instead I wanted to go into nursing. I went to a 22-month RN diploma program at Ohio Valley General Hospital and graduated from there in 1995. So that starts to show my age a little bit. Thanks. I worked as a nurse for 12 years and decided that I wanted to get into anesthesia. So I went to Waynesburg University out at South Point to get my bachelor's, and that was a 18-month program. Now, I went there with every intention of becoming a nurse anesthetist, but it's really hard to get into anesthesia school. So I kind of took a chance as far as getting my bachelor's. Was it really going to be worth it? Was I really going to get into a master's program? So I was fortunate enough to do well. I got into Allegheny Valley Hospital of Nurse Anesthesia, which is way up in Natrona Heights. So it was quite a drive for me, up 28 every morning. But that took 24 months to complete. And I got a master's in health science from La Roche College, and I got my anesthesia certificate from Allegheny Valley Hospital. So my clinical nursing path, I got right into ICU out of nursing school. I worked in a variety of different ICU settings. I'd say most of my nursing experience is in a surgical ICU or cardiovascular surgical ICU. So I took care of patients that were getting open heart surgery. So it's highly acute as far as the type of nurse that I became. I had to learn a lot about drugs, physiological processes. I took care of a lot of sick patients, but that really kind of prepared me for the stress that I was going to face in anesthesia. I'd become basic life certified, ACLS, advanced cardiac life support certified. I became a member of the American Association of Critical Care Nurses, and I got CCRN certified, which is if you want to go ahead and become a nurse anesthesia student, I'd have to say that was the one thing that helped me the most. It really made me learn what I needed to know to get through the interviews so that I could get accepted into anesthesia school. And I had a total of 12 years critical care nursing experience before I went to CRNA school. Most places only need you to have one. Why did I do it? I wanted to be challenged. I worked in the same place for about 12 years. I got to be a clinical resource person. I really sometimes still do miss it, but I wanted to have a change and do something different. A lot of the CRNAs were always very happy that I met. Not to bash nursing, but you will meet a lot of unhappy nurses in certain places. All the CRNAs I met, they were all happy. They were well respected. I wasn't sure if the reason that they were so happy was the amount of money that they were making. I figured maybe that was why they were so happy. In Pittsburgh, the average starting CRNA salary is $120,000 whenever I got out of anesthesia school. I don't want this to come out wrong. I really thought at that point, oh my goodness, $120,000 a year. All the CRNAs I met were working two jobs. I'm thinking, why would you need to work two jobs? Well, I found out why you need to work two jobs. You have a lot of student loans. There was a lot of sacrifice involved. It was really competitive to get in. I was fortunate that I was able to get right into anesthesia school. Some of the people that I met, that I worked with, that applied, they've applied 4 or 5 times, 5 years in a row, and they haven't been able to get in. I had to quit work for 2 years. A lot of places will suggest you quit work. Some places will make you quit work. I did work, go to school with a few people who would work full-time on the weekends, like 12-hour shifts, and then they just didn't have time to study. They really struggled to get through school. I do have large student loans. I'll probably be paying them off until I put my kids through college. There's a lot of demanding academics and clinical requirements. I would study, and study some more. And then early hours, sometimes I get up at 3:30 in the morning to make it to clinical all the way up in Natrona Heights. And sometimes I wouldn't even get home until 7 o'clock at night. So early hours, long days, little sleep, and a lot of high stress. I know I'm probably not setting it up too nicely right now, but believe me, I really think that it's worth it. So minimal admission requirements to get into a school. There's three certain schools within the Pittsburgh area. You need a year of critical nursing experience. You need to really make sure that you have a strong grade point average. Most places require you to have a baccalaureate GPA of about 3.5. You can get in with a 3.0, but there's different levels of getting into anesthesia school. You can get, you know, accepted right away. They can put you on a waiting list where they're calling you 2 weeks before because somebody else who they offered the spot to didn't want it. But then you're, you know, kind of stuck trying to, you know, get out of your job, financially plan for it, that sort of thing. You want to get really good professional references. You want to be able to interview well. It was quite a grueling interview process. You want to get good scores on GREs. Basically, that's like your SATs for graduate school. And some places will make you do a Miller analogy exam. I did not go that route. I had to do the GREs. It's really competitive. The year that I got in, there were 96 applicants for 18 spots, and we only graduated 13. One person did quit. The rest were asked to leave the program. So if you want to do this, what should you do? You want to get, after you get your nursing degree, which you can either go to a two-year program, like I did, through a hospital to get your nursing degree, you get a diploma at that point. You can go to a four-year bachelor's degree where, you know, you're set up and you have your bachelor's and you can get right into a master's program. Since I had a diploma, I had to go back and get my bachelor's through Waynesburg while I was working.
Do you think that might have ended up helping you in the end, that you got practical experience with that 2 year?
I really think that it did. Whenever I got into anesthesia school, like I said, I had been a nurse for about 12 years, and it was all ICU experience. So the people that were teaching me, and then whenever I got out of anesthesia school and I was teaching students, there's a big difference that you notice from somebody who has 1 year of critical care experience versus somebody that has 12 years of critical care experience. Whenever you're getting that experience as a nurse, you are just faced with different challenges every day, every month, every year that you're there. And it makes you more aware of different things. It gives you better assessment skills, better idea of what you're getting into and how to prepare. I think 90% of my job is being prepared for the worst, expecting the worst. Not that it's always going to happen, but you kind of have your game plan. You're always thinking ahead. And I think that that's part of getting some strong critical care experience. Whenever you're in critical care, it's different than being on the floors as a nurse because your doctors expect you to know what to do. They're not there all the time. They expect you to be able to make those critical care and those critical thinking decisions before you wake them up at 2 in the morning and tell them that they need to come back in and operate on somebody. You don't want to call them at 2 o'clock in the morning if you're not sure. And you want to have a deep understanding of the underlying pathology. What's wrong with people? Why are their lungs sick? Why are their hearts sick? The pharmacology that goes along with that. What drugs do they really need? Why are they getting them? How do they work? What are the side effects? And you want to be confident and competent, but you don't want to be overconfident. You need to know your limitations. And whenever you go in and you are interviewed for your job, they're going to go through this and you are going to feel like you've kind of been put through the ringer. They want to know your personality. They want to really get a feel for your understanding and how they make the actual interview process stressful, just to see how you react to the stress. You want to focus on math and science when you're in high school. You really want to do that whenever you're in college. You want to make sure you keep a strong grade point average and really do well in those classes. And I would recommend when you're a nurse, if you're working in critical care, to get what's something that's called CCRN certified. I think this is invaluable. This is what prepared me the most for my interview process. What that does is it basically concentrates on all the different pathophysiological problems, what's wrong with everybody, what you do to fix them, what the drugs do, how they work, you know, different vital signs problems, and things like that. And I'd have to say that my anesthesia interview was basically this written test, but in a verbal form. And it wasn't enough when I interviewed to give her the right answers. She would take your right answer and then kind of delve into it a little bit more until she got really down to the most detailed thing she could get to and see how I dealt with that.
What does that stand for, the CCRN?
CCRN is your Critical Care Registered Nursing certification. They make you, before you can actually sit for that exam, get so many clinical hours in an ICU per year, and it also, it's a pretty intense exam. I think I studied at home for a year before I actually sat and took that exam. There's three Pittsburgh schools right now where you can go to anesthesia school. Pitt, which you get a master's in nursing, is 28 months long. It is a nationally ranked program. It varies within the top 5 to the top 10, but I have to say that is nationally known for being a really strong anesthesia school. Allegheny Hospital, LaRose College, you get a master's in health science. That's where I went. That's what I have, and it was a 24-month program. If you notice, it's shorter than Pitt, and it's shorter than Accela. It's much more condensed. I had to quit work to go to school, so I didn't want to quit work for 3.5 years. I wanted to quit work for the shortest amount of time possible. And then there's Accela Health through St. Vincent's College, where you also get a master's in health science, and it's 27.5 months long. Pitt's nice because it's in town. Basically, a lot of the clinicals are around the city. Allegheny Valley, I had to go up to Natrona Heights. It's a bit of a haul from Bethel Park, but everything else was pretty much close by. St. Clair Hospital, I did clinical, Allegheny Valley, Allegheny General, West Penn Hospital, Swickley, those sorts of things. Accela Health kind of concerned me whenever I was applying to school because you have to go to Johnstown and Erie and all those sorts of places. And, you know, if you're going to clinical at 5 a.m. in the morning and you're getting done at 6, there's no way you're making it home. A lot of times kids will get apartments and things like that, and that just adds to how much money you have to spend while you're in school. And the AANA is the American Association of Nurse Anesthetists. That is our governing body for what we do for a living, and they're going to support a doctorate degree to get out of school to be a CRNA. So it's still kind of in the works. That's supposed to start in 2025. So as far as the actual setup for how long school will the type of schools that I want to continue to exist or be able to give people educations beyond a master's in health science? So some CRNA statistics, over about 75% of the anesthetics are given by nurse anesthetists. There's anesthesiologists, but the nurse anesthetists give about 75%. In Pennsylvania, they make anywhere from $125,000 to $180,000 per year. We don't have any prescriptive authority. We cannot write prescriptions for patients. And I work under an MDA, which is a medical doctor in anesthesia. So we work under what is called an anesthesia care team model. So basically, one MDA will supervise up to 4 rooms or 4 nurse anesthetists, but they can't be everywhere at once. Nationally, you make anywhere from $100,000 to $350,000 per year. States are starting to grant prescriptive authority to certain CRNAs. You know, North Dakota, there's not many anesthesiologists up there. Sometimes there's no anesthesiologist. You are the sole anesthesia provider depending on what state you work in. And in 17 states, CRNAs do practice independent of an anesthesiologist. And their supervision is more under the surgeon, who's going to be their doctor in their room, who is watching over them. However, most surgeons really don't know the depth of what we do and the type of drugs that we use. And even though they're currently signing under those surgeons, you know, they're not the anesthesia provider in that room. You are. And it all depends on the state's Nurse Practice Act. In the state of Pennsylvania, I'm required to work under the direct physician of a supervision. And, you know, I am a nurse. I did go to school to be a nurse. You know, I didn't go to school to be a doctor. So I do like having that nurse or that doctor backup. I mean, I have a lot of autonomy with what I do, but it is nice to know that there's another set of hands to help you out if you get into trouble. So the definition of anesthesia is a temporary state consisting of unconsciousness, loss of memory, lack of pain, and muscle relaxation. This is an anesthesia machine. It is present in probably about 98% of the rooms that I give anesthesia in. So you have to learn this thing inside and out and how to fix it and that sort of stuff, which, you know, I'm not a mechanic. That was probably one of my hardest parts of anesthesia school. And, you know, the gas that we keep people asleep with, the monitors. So basically, our responsibilities, you become an expert in a lot of things. You're the airway expert, you're an IV, intravenous, IV line, central line, arterial line expert. You become basically a lot of the critical care resource person for a lot of the nurses in the hospital that you work with. They can't get IV lines. If they have a patient that doesn't quite look right, if they need somebody who needs emergently intubated, they have a patient who's in cardiac arrest, you're the person pushing the drugs, you're the person doing the CPR, you're the person getting the airway into them and really helping get that patient hopefully through, you know, a really hard time. We do the pre-anesthetic evaluation with the doctors. What are their comorbidities? What other kinds of problems do they have? Have they had other surgeries? Do they have problems with the anesthesia? Have they had heart attacks, strokes? Are they somebody who looks like they're going to be a difficult intubation? You know, really hard to get an airway into them. We do anesthesia induction, maintenance, and emergence. Induction, we like to refer to as almost like take off with a plane. You're getting them off to sleep. And then they refer to emergences like landing. Those are the two critical parts of anesthesia. And then we do post-anesthesia care. We check on them in the PACU, make sure that they're doing okay. My job requires vigilance. Every day, my split-second decisions depend on whether or not a person survives through their surgery or if they have complications or that sort of thing. Schedules, nurses generally work around the clock. Before you get into anesthesia school, you'll be a nurse somewhere, working weekends, holidays, you know, depending on what you want to do. If you're working in ICU, generally you're going to be there on Christmas and Thanksgiving and Saturday and Sunday. However, anesthesia, if you work in a surgical place that's freestanding, that it's not connected to a hospital like a surgery center, you're going to be off weekends, you're going to be off holidays, you're not going to have to work night shift or take call. Anesthesia does start early. I start between 6 and 6:30 every morning, and you can work any variety of shifts. I used to work 24-hour trauma call at AGH, and I'd be off for 3 days afterwards. It took me a while to recover if I was up for 24 hours working straight, but I take call from home now once a week. So generally, I get home 6, 7, 8 o'clock at night if I'm on call, and hopefully I don't have to go back. Our job is highly stressful at times. Difficult airways, like I said, during induction, generally you can look at somebody and know what kind of trouble you may or may not be in whenever you're going to sleep. Waking up, you know, that's a critical time, depending on what they've had done. You know, there are some people who generally don't react to anesthesia well, and they're trying to pull out every line and tube, jump off the OR table, occasionally punch you, that sort of thing. So that's always, you know, not a good part of my job. Trauma, if you're doing OB, you're responsible to the mom and the baby if you're in obstetrics. You get exposed to a lot of communicable diseases, blood. You know, I've taken care of HIV patients, patients with hepatitis B. You just have to make sure that you'd use universal precautions. You know, I always have a mask over on my face, gloves, gown if you need it. Last week we had a patient show up with lice in the operating room. I was very happy that it wasn't my patient. But that sort of thing, you know, people trying to spit on you, bite you, you know, that sort of thing. So sometimes you have difficult surgeons or anesthesiologists, and there is a high risk of losses with what I do. You always got to prepare for the worst, expect it, but it doesn't mean it's always going to happen. You just want to always be prepared. And you're your patient's biggest advocate while they're sleeping. They can't protect themselves. They can't ask you anything. You kind of got to look for their physical symptoms on their vital signs, things like that, to see if they're in pain. You can actually look at your monitors and tell a lot about what's going on with your patient. Characteristics, you have to be assertive. You basically lead the operating room. You set the tone for how fast or how slow you're going. If it's somebody that's going to be a difficult intubation, you know that you need to take your time. You need to prepare things. You need to make sure that everything is very controlled. Unfortunately, when you work in a trauma center, you have patients literally rolling through the door. They're pumping on their chest. You need to be really, really fast to get them asleep. So you kind of set the tempo. You know, if you're in a hurry, your OR is going to be in a hurry. If you want things to be more calm and subdued, they're going to take your cue and do that. Same with waking up. Last week, I had a patient who I had to take all their breathing devices out while they were still really, really asleep. And whenever you do that, and you what we call pull them deep, you can't have people knocking around, banging things off the walls, goofing off, that sort of thing. And I had to really tell my OR to settle down. They weren't very happy with me, but had they started to make a lot of noise and stimulated that patient whenever they needed to be kind of quyet and asleep, he could have laryngospasmed and died. So it's those sorts of things. And they know whenever we're talking about airways, that we mean business. I'd have to say that's the thing that we're most possessive about. So you need to be responsible and vigilant. You're responsible for the airway that you have in, the endotracheal tube, any IVs that are in, how deep they are, how stable their vital signs are, patient positioning, fluid and electrolyte management, pain management, all sorts of things depending on the type of surgery that they're having. You have to prioritize your care quickly and accurately, handle stressful situations well, and you can't be, you know, easily sickened by gross things. I will come home sometimes and try to tell my family what I think are the coolest things that I've done for that day, and nobody wants to hear it but my oldest daughter, because it doesn't gross her out and she likes to watch trauma, life in the ER all the time. I'm embarrassing her because she's in here now. So you're exposed to a lot of blood, a lot of sputum, and vomit. I mean, I'm trying to put endotracheal tubes in while people are constantly throwing up. You don't want it to go in their lungs. You definitely don't want it to hit you. And you can't even see where you're trying to put the tube, so you kind of need to be very confident. There's not an option for failure a lot of times in my job. It's not like I'm not scared to death at certain points, but you just need to be confident in your skills that you can take care of it. So you are highly skilled. There's somebody putting an epidural right here. Somebody's bag mask ventilating somebody up there with the anesthesia machine, getting ready to get them with an IV induction, making sure that they're breathing a lot of oxygen before you put them off to sleep so we have some extra time. Generally, people tell you 3 to 5 minutes, no oxygen, a person's dead. When we pre-oxygenate people, sometimes we can buy upwards of 5 to 10 minutes to get an endotracheal tube in somebody without them having any brain damage, just by making sure that we pre-oxygenate people. And that's just a central line kit. So, you know, putting IVs in people's necks, putting IVs, you know, people's, you know, wrists, we put monitoring devices in their artery. We have learned how to do different nerve blocks. We can block just about any nerve in your body, and we learn how to do that in the anesthesia school. Be compassionate. Sometimes this is the first thing that somebody sees. They're in a trauma. They're scared to death. They're going to die. There's something wrong with them. They think they may have cancer. They're going to get, you know, different types of procedures done. Sometimes they're not really sure that they're going to wake up from their surgery. So all I can say is one of the most things we have to do, even though we're skilled at what we do and there's a lot of technical things involved, we really need to be compassionate to our patients because, you know, I would be scared if somebody just came at me looking like this and I don't even know who they are. You can't see their face. Most rewarding thing that I do, a lot of people get into what I do for the money. Some say it's for the respect. I agree with both of those, but a lot of times people will say, thank you so much for your kindness and for being so kind to me. Figure they're sick, they're not feeling well, they're scared. You don't want to be mean to them. I try to treat my patients with respect and empathy during the most stressful times in their lives. I've had patients come in who are afraid they're going to die. And I'll have to say there are times where, you know, you're standing above your patient, you have the oxygen mask on, and you're looking into their eyes, and you're telling them, take a deep breath. I'm going to take good care of you. And they know that they may die during that surgery. There have been times where I am the last person that somebody has seen. They've looked into my eyes. I'm the last voice that they have heard. And I think that it is, even though one of the hardest parts of my job, I'm almost honored to be there with them, knowing that I'm making the last moments of their life. As caring as I possibly can, because I am the last person that they see. They have made it through the surgery, but they die a short time after. They never wake up. You know, I have taken care of a lot of trauma patients that way. Some older people that have some really bad things done with their stomachs, it's called dead gut. It's a really nasty thing to have, that they know that their chances of pulling out of surgery aren't that great, but you need to make it calm for them. You need to make it as much empathy as you can. So look into the future. If this looks like something that you want to do, concentrate in your science and math. Make sure you keep your grades strong. Get your RN, and if you decide to take the route like I did where you have to go back for your bachelor's, you know, that's your 4-year degree, do that. Get a lot of ICU experience. Any type of ICU will work. I recommend cardiac. I think that basically provides you with the most type of experience you need to take care of people that are in cardiac arrest. That's all the drugs that you know inside and out. people that had different types of ICU and experience in anesthesia school, whether it be neurosurgical, that sort of thing, they generally struggled a little bit more with the cardiac rotation that we did. Get your critical care registered nurse certification. Become a member of the American Association of Critical Care Nurses. They have a lot of really good references for you, things for you to learn a little bit more about what you're doing and get more critical care experience before you apply to school. Get on your nursing committees at work whenever you're a nurse and be active in education of the staff and bettering things wherever you work. And then shadow a CRNA. You can do it as a student in high school. I've had a lot of different high school students from all over the place, friends that I know. Their friends and family have come in with me and spent a day with me in the operating room. So any one of you, I'll leave my email. You can contact me. I'll be happy to bring you for a day where I work. Or whenever you're a nurse, wherever you're working, get to know the CRNAs that you work with. A lot of times we are very welcoming and we'll tell you the books to buy, the best references that we use, the things that we use to help us through school the most, the things that we did to pass anesthesia boards, because that is about another 4 months of just constant studying so that you pass your boards. And that's about all that I have. Does anybody have any questions for me? Did I talk too fast? I do talk fast.
Do you recommend that students start to volunteer as early as they can?
I think so.
Definitely getting exposed to a hospital?
I think so. I did volunteer at St. Clair Hospital when I was in high school. And I think that it kind of gets you in with some of the nurses. You realize that once you do go to nursing school, you kind of already know some nurses there. It can be quite intimidating to walk into a hospital and to have never been there before, to not have seen any of the equipment, to not know the layout of the hospitals, to not, you know, just even from volunteering, you get to more exposure to different things, and you kind of know what to expect whenever you walk in. So I'm sure you've heard of whenever patients come in and, you know, your moms are having babies, the epidurals, spinals, different things to block from different levels all the way down for different surgeries. Epidurals and spinals you hear a lot with people that are having babies. The spinals we do a lot for people having total knees, total joints, total hips, that sort of thing. So you do learn to block every nerve in the body. You know, you can stick needles up here and block the shoulder, block the elbow, block the arm, block the ankle, so that we don't always have to put you totally asleep. We can keep you asleep, breathing on your own with some different kinds of drugs, but you don't have to have a breathing tube placed. You know, there's always risk with any type of surgery, any type of anesthetic. We do what we can to basically pick the right type of anesthetic for our patients with the lowest risk.
This is not a, you go to 2 years of school or even 4 years of school and get to do this job. This is training upon training upon training. So salary looks fantastic, but the training is up there.
And I think, and that's the thing, like whenever I looked at what nurses make, or CRNAs make, I thought, oh my goodness, they're all working two jobs. What are they working so much for? These people are making, you know, $120,000 a year. So I went back to school, quit my job, figured, hey, when I get out, I'm going to have a great paycheck, not realizing that I really took out a lot of student loans. There are some places that will stipend you. They'll give you money while you're in school to live on. They'll pay for your education. But generally, those places are basically asking for 5 years. You can't get out of your contract. They basically own you for 5 years. I will say one of the things that they do have around here is you get sign-on bonuses. When I got out of anesthesia school, UPMC was offering a $50,000 sign-on bonus. Post-taxes, you got $30,000, but they owned you for, I think, 3 years, which is nice because whenever, you know, they call it like a tuition forgiveness type of a thing, so you can use $30,000 to pay back towards your anesthesia schooling. I'd have to say when I went back for my bachelor's, that was about $18,000 extra. All of my other student loans from Pitt and nursing, all that was kind of paid off. Anesthesia bachelor's was about $20,000, which sometimes if you work as a nurse and you agree to continue working there, they'll give you $2,000 a year tuition reimbursement. You just have to agree to continue to work there for about 2 years afterwards. So it's nice if you want to do it slowly. It's kind of a drop in the bucket if you want to do it really fast. Allegheny Journal, whenever I went back to school, they were offering $20,000. That's what I took, was $20,000. I didn't see a lot of it. You know what I mean? By the time they take taxes out, I think I saw about $12,000. Again, it sounds like a lot of money, but whenever you're taking out anywhere from $50,000 to $150,000 in student loans, depending on, you know, if you're quitting your job or you still work, and how financially prepared were you to quit your job for 2 years and go back? I know some people that really didn't have to take out a lot of money. They maybe took out $30,000 in student loans. They paid it all back and they're set. There are other people that have had to take out $100,000, $150,000, $200,000 in student loans, and then they have to take, you know, and pay those back over a long period of time. So, I mean, we learn to do everything that an anesthesiologist does. But an anesthesiologist, you know, went to their undergraduate. They went to med school for a lot of years. They went to residency for a lot of years. So, you know, we do learn to do exactly what they do, but we have a nursing background. We learn from the same books. We learn all the same principles. They come out with their MD, and we have a CRNA. You know, you have to be a people person to kind of be a nursing, because you are exposed to all different kinds of people and people that are really scared of you. I had a lady the other day. I went to put an IV in her. She levitated off the bed. She nearly kneed me in the head. And I got the IV in, and she was still screaming. So, you know, it's a little bit hard. But the really good thing about my job is people are usually very happy to see me because I am the girl with the really good drugs hanging out in my pocket. So as soon as everything's signed and they're all ready to go back, I give them some Versed through their IV, and then they are very, very relaxed. So I'm somebody who can take their anxiety away, and it's a really nice thing to do. Not a lot of people can say that they can give medications and totally change their patient's outlook at that point. So I'd have to say it's different, though. You know, when I was working as a nurse, I would work with the same patients day in and day out for 12 hours. It sometimes can be quite draining on you. You know, I see my patients. If they're not the most happy patient or they tend to be a little more stressful, whenever you're done, you drop them off the PACU. You take them back to ICU. You can check in on them. But at that point, you know, your job is basically done. They're asleep. So no matter how upset they are before they go to sleep, sometimes they wake up not so happy. But a lot of times people wake up and be like, oh, that really wasn't that bad, you know? Yes?
You said by 2025 that, like, it'll be required to have, like, a doctor's practice as a...
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
Yes.
Now, will current CRNAs be, like, grandfathered in?
We will be grandfathered in, yes. And it's kind of difficult as far as, you know, people who get a PIT, they have a master's in nursing. I have a master's in health science. So if I would go back for a doctorate, there's different type of doctorates. I'd have to get, you know, a different type of doctorate. It wouldn't be in nursing. It's like a doctor of nurse anesthesia practice, something along those lines. But I won't be. Now, as of right now, people have not had to recertify for their boards either. But the American Association of Nurse Anesthetists is starting to make it where they're starting to work us into where we're going to have to recertify for our boards too. So we're all looking forward to that.
Is there a lot of continuing ed?
There is. Right now I have four.
Coming out, so.
I have to get 40 continuing education credits per year, but they're going to change that. It's all evolving once we have to sit there and retest. But we get to take a lot of nice, cool vacations all over the world, so that's one good thing.
All right, thank you.
All right, thanks.